Hi again everyone, Chris Tisdell here again. In this presentation, I'm going to continue my series of videos on complex numbers. Now, in previous presentations, we talked about regions in the complex plane and how to describe them and how to determine them. So in this video, I'm going to do an example showing you how to determine regions. Okay, so let me share my screen with you and we can start. All right, so let me just get the focus on this right. All right, so we are given the following problem. Determine and sketch the set of points in the complex plane that satisfy this equation here. Now, let's just remind ourselves about a bit of the notation. Say Z is a complex number, and in Cartesian form, it's written like this, where X and Y are the real and imaginary parts, respectively. And the complex plane has a horizontal axis known as the real axis and an imaginary axis, which is a vertical axis. Okay, so here it is here. And along the real axis, you have, say, 1, 2, 3. Along the imaginary axis, you have I, 2i, 3i, 4i, etc. And if you were to plot, say, a point in the complex plane, say some point z, and draw a little line segment joining the point to the origin, this distance here is known as the modulus of z, okay? And it's we use these sort of two vertical lines to denote the modulus of it, and it's basically by Pythagoras, it's just the sum of the squares of x and y and just square root it. Okay? Now, if this measures the distance from a point to the origin, what do these things do? Well, it's on a similar tip if I write it like this. This here says that we're interested in the point Z whose distance between the point Z and the point negative 3, which will lie on the real axis over here, is twice times or two times the distance from Z to 6i, which will lie somewhere up here on the imaginary axis. So they're the set of points that we're interested in. So how do we actually sort it out? Well, we're going to use algebra to do it. So basically, let's rewrite z as in this Cartesian form. And to simplify things, because we don't want to involve square root signs if we don't have to, we can square both sides. So when I say that, I mean I'm squaring both sides. We obtain the following. Okay, so we've got z plus 3 all squared equals 4 times z minus 6i all squared. Okay, now in the Cartesian form, let's replace z with x plus yi, and I'll get the following. I'm just going to put the 3 and the real part of z together. And over here, because I've got a complex, I've got an I here, z minus 6i will be x plus yi minus 6i. So I can group the imaginary parts together. And this is what I want now. Now, because I've got the square of these things, I can basically square up here and here, and I'll just have the square of this plus y squared equals 4 times the square of this plus the square of this, okay? So let me show you that. So I'm going to square that x plus 3. I'm going to add the square of the coefficient of I. I'm going to square that x. I'm going to square the coefficient of I here. So now we've got something that looks like a Cartesian form, and our our challenge now is to simplify this into something that's recognizable. So let's expand. Okay, so over here I'm going to get x squared plus 6x plus 9. And over here, I'm going to get y squared minus 12y plus 36. So if I expand, if I distribute the 4, I'm going to get something like the following. So minus 12 times 4, minus 48. And 36 times 4 is going to be 144. All right, so now let's rearrange. Let's put all the variables on one side and all the numbers on the other side. So let's rearrange to obtain the following. Okay, well the x squared will go over there, the 6x will go over there, the y squared will go over there. So if we do that, I'll get something like this. And the positive 144 will go over there. So I'll get negative 135. Now, it's starting to look like the equation of a circle because the coefficients of the x squareds and y squareds are the same. Okay, so let's divide by 3 and make the coefficient of x squared and y squared 1. So that'll be 16. And if I divide negative 135 by 3, I'll get negative 45. Negative 45 there. Okay, so now what I can do is complete the square in x and y, because what I'm looking for here is something that's familiar. And if I complete the square in x and y, I'll get the equation of a circle where you know the center of the circle and the radius. Okay, so let me start a new page. Let's complete the square in x and y to obtain the following. Okay, well, look at the coefficient of x. It's negative 2. Take half of that, square it, add it to both sides and take it away. So I'll get something like this. Yeah, and I'll add one in on the other side in a minute. Look at half the coefficient of y, so that's negative 16, half of that's negative 8. Square that, add it to both sides. Okay, so negative 45 plus 1 plus 64. So now I can just simplify this. It'll be x minus 1 all squared plus y minus 8 all squared equals whatever this is. So that'll be 65 minus 45, which is 20. Okay, so now we have the form of a recognizable curve. It is going to be a circle with radius root 20 and center at 1 plus 8i. Okay? So we have a circle in the complex plane with center at 1 plus 8i and radius root 20, which we'll simplify down to 2 root 5. So now we've determined what the set of points are. What do they look like in the complex plane? So let me just share my screen with you and use GeoGebra to give you a little look at what the circle will look like. Well, here you've got the z1 at the point 1 plus 8i, and then I've just used this equation here to graph the circle. So this blue circle is the set of points that we're interested in. Okay, so that's my presentation. Hope you enjoyed it. Hope you found it useful. If you have any more questions, any comments, any feedback, any suggestions, please feel free to put them in the comment section below. Please join me for my next presentation where I'll continue my series of videos on complex numbers. Thanks for watching. Hope to see you soon. Bye.